And hopefully next week we can start giving joint introduction to assignment 3. So we're going to overview assignment 2. Today we're going to cover the process model, process structure, so process systems in general. We're going to cover the get PID and fork, wait PID, exit, and exec V. So by now you should have the file syscalls implemented. You should already start with process syscall. If you did finish your file syscall by last Friday, that means you're on track and on time. Because you do need at least around 2 weeks for process syscall to complete them. So the deadline is going to be not this Friday, but the after, on March 17th. So let's start by reviewing what we've covered up until now. So we've said that a process basically contains a thread or multiple threads, but in OS161 we only have one thread. Contains an address space that is private to that process, contains a file table that is private to the process, and once you start forking, you're going to start copying the thread, first thread, so, and then you're going to start copying the address space, the file table, which again, it has to be private to that child process that is created. And you're going to already have console initialized. Then that means you're going to copy over the references to the console file handler. Without creating or initializing the console all over again. And if you have any other files that are already open, then you're gonna just like reference the file handle in the new child process and increase the reference count by 1. So the file handle, as we said, that it is a private to each process. Unless you start forking, then it's gonna be shared between the parent process and the child process. The file object is basically shared system-wide. So we have 3 levels of indirection: file table, file handle, and then file object. So starting with the process syscalls, again, you do need the data structures or framework that will handle the processes. So you should have, every process should have its own structure that's already given to you, but it's not complete. You need to add a lot more stuff to it. So beside what is given to you in proc.edge in the existing process structure, which let's have a look, what do we have in it? So we do have a name and a spin lock and number of threads that should always be 1, since OS161 only has 1 thread. And then you also have an address space and current working directory of the current process. So beside all of these, what you need to add into a process structure is a reference to process threads. So every process should be able to identify what threads it did the longest to it, and every thread should know what is the process that it belongs to. So just like every process should know what are the threads that it has, and every thread should know what is the process that it belongs to. So you should have a reference in the process structure, you should have a reference to process threads, in our case, 1 thread. You should have the file table, which maintains references to file handles. And you should have a PID, which is a process ID, and process ID should be unique for every process. You should also have the PPID, which is the parent process ID. So once the fork can create a new process, child process, the PPID should be set to the PID of the parent. You should also have an exit status, which tells us if that process did exit or not. And then, you should also have an exit code that would tell you what is, if the process exited, then what is that code for the, or the exit code for that process. which will be collected by the parent process later on. You should also have some synchronization primitives in your process structure that will just like synchronize between the parent and the child. So the parent and wait PID could go to sleep waiting for the child to exit and collect the exit. So these are the major stuff that you should have in process structure. That doesn't mean it covers everything, but these are the major information that you should maintain in the process structure. But you could also add some other stuff to it that you will need based on your data structures that you are going to start implementing. Process table design. So as we said that every process in OS161, every process contains only one thread. And a process and its thread should be able to identify each other. So process table is similar to the file table, but I'm not going to use the word of a table, just like an array, because you should decide how you're going to design your data structure. So I'm going to say just like process table is a data structure that maps the PID to the process structure. How should you implement it? So you can go with an array, or you can go with a linked list. However, linked list is much better because you're not going to waste space. Since for the file table, it did make sense to use an array because only 64, but not for processes. So linked list would be a better design option, but still, it's up to you. You can test with both. What are the requirements for a process table? So when you create a new process, that table should be able to allocate a new PID for that new process. And allocating a new PID meaning that you need to allocate a new process structure. So how should you allocate a PID? There are several approaches. So some students were just like thinking of just like using, or if you are using a static array, then you're going to use, some people would use indexes, and then you go back once you run out of index, but that's not really a good practice. We would recommend that you would use an increasing counter for your PID, allocating PIDs. And in limits.h, you do have a PID max, which is still tells you that you could just like modify it. So, and this is limits.h, where you have the max, PID max. Now this is max value for process ID. Change this to match your implementation. I would recommend that keep that as it is and use an increasing counter. If you then run out of, or run into problems, then you might want to consider changing that. But for the minimum one, you need to start making sure that you start, the minimum should be 2. That means you need to start from 3. So 1 or 2 are, I think you can start with 2. Yes, so you cannot definitely start with 0 or 1. These are reserved. As long as I know, the 1 is reserved for the kernel process. And you have these, if you search for them in, I think, kernel PID, if you search for that, you could retrieve that. So this is for allocating a new PID. The other thing that you need to your process table should be able to do is that given a PID, it should be able to retrieve the process structure. And when a process exits, it should be able to destroy the process structure. So depending on how you implement your process table, you should just like, as if it's a linked list, then you need to destroy that process structure. If it's an array that's pointing to a process structure, again, you need to destroy it. but you don't need to recycle, for example, the PID. The PID should be only deallocated. So whenever I inquire about the PID, I give you a PID, it should tell me that this is an invalid PID since the process did enter and you're done. So these are basically the requirements for process table design. Any question on process structure and process table? Okay, starting with the process syscalls, starting with the easiest one, this is the getPID. This basically will return the ID of the current process that calls that syscall. And if you also look into the man pages, so for getPID, getPID doesn't fail. So there is no. So that is the most easiest syscall that you need to implement. Basically, returning the process ID of the current process. Now, starting with fork. So this is an example of a user program that you could write to test fork. Test, exit, and wait PID syscalls. So what it does is basically fork. The parent process would call fork, and at this stage, two processes, we will have two processes instead of one. So with the parent process, now we will continue into the if statement where we will start to branch based on the current process. So if the current process is the parent process and the fork did successfully complete, then we're going to go into that, into the last branch where we're going to call wait PID, and that would put the parent process ID into sleep, waiting for the child process to exit. And if the current process is a child process, on the other hand, then we're going to branch into the PID 0. Why is that? Because fork returns twice. With child, it returns 0. With the parent, it returns the child process ID. So we have else here because any positive value, that's what we mean, because the PID would be a positive value. So any positive value would branch into the waited section for the statement. And if the return value of fork is 0, then that means the current process is the child process, and it will branch into the PID called 0. Here, the child process will basically print that on the child and then call the exit passing that the exit success. That's just like an example, a code that shows that we're successfully executed. So, just like obtaining the exit code. And then that basically a user program that you can test fork with. And it's a good idea to have that before you start implementing or after you implement your fork, you should have something like this to test your fork. So what is a fork? A fork is a syscall that creates an exact copy of the calling process, but with a few exceptions. It's not really an exact copy, it's an almost copy. So after fork, the process we'll call fork will be the parent process, and the one that is created is the child process. Now, we have some points that you need to consider while implementing fork. One of them, what should you copy, what shouldn't you copy, and what should be shared between the two processes, the parent and the child. So what should we copy? First, we should copy the parent struct frame, the context of the parent, and that should be saved in the kernel's heap using kmalloc. You should also copy the parent's address space, how you should do that. The address space has its own framework that is given to you, which you should complete. It's not completed, but you can use it. It's just like dumb VM version. So in address.h, you have all these functions, address space functions that you can call, which one of them is as copy. So you can use that function to copy the parent's address space and create an address space for the child process. So this is the node that tells you this is the dumb VM version. So note that this is using dumb VM. And assign three, you're going to complete all these, just like re-implement all these interfaces. So this is how you should go about copying the parent's address space. Then you have the parent's file table, and that's basically your implementation. So you should have the functionality. Your file table should provide you, you should have already implemented that functionality that will allow you to copy the file table into the child's file table, having in mind things that should be shared between the two processes. So these are the stuff that you should copy. There are some stuff that you shouldn't copy, like the PID. As we said, the process ID should be unique to every process. So the child PID, the child should get a new PID. The PPID should be assigned to the parents, to the process that called for, which is the parent process PID. If you just like copy it over, then it will have the parent's parent PID. So make sure that this is set to the correct parent PID. Now you have the return value of fork that shouldn't be copied over from the parent to the child. And this is where you need to recall the MEPS return value convention, where things are, the return value is saved in V0 and V1, and the A3 register should be set to 0 to indicate success. So these are the stuff that should not be copied over to the child process. What about the stuff that should be shared between them? At this point, all of you should know what are the stuff that should be shared between these two processes. So like file handles, for example. You need to figure these out. So these three main stuff that you need to really consider while implementing fork: what should be copied, what shouldn't be copied, what should be shared between both. So as a result, how summarizing how to fork work, it should first create a new child process with a new PID, and then you need to set the PPID to the parent's PID, copy the parent's track frame, copy the parent's address space, copy the parent's file table. While you're copying this stuff, you should have in mind the stuff that should be copied and should be copied and should be shared. So, for example, the trash thing shouldn't be copied fully to the child. And then once you're done with the copying, then you need to call thread fork, which should do the remaining work for you. I've got some questions about thread fork and the stuff that you need to pass to the thread fork. I think I shouldn't go into that much detail, but if you couldn't find answers in the comments in the thread.h or thread.c, then do search for thread fork, because it's being used before and it is already used in your in the source tree. So you should find examples that how should thread fork be used and what should receive and what. So as we said, fork returns twice, to returns ones for the child process, with the child process returning zero, and with the parent process, it returns the child process ID. So, any questions? So wait PID. So that is used with the parent process to wait for the child process to exit. And again, some points that you need to think about while implementing PID, wait PID, is to check if the PID passed is, again, valid because, and wait PID, what we receive is an PID. We receive also a pointer that will hold the status, and then we receive options. Please, for the process syscall, go through, fully read the man pages. It gives you a lot of information on and answers to how you should implement these syscalls. So for the PID, again, we need to check if that process, if that PID is a valid PID, that is, that points to a process structure. And then we also need to check if that process structure is a child of the calling process, the current process, which is the parent process. So, and that parent process is allowed to wait for that process, child process to exit. You also need to check if the status pointer is valid, since it's a pointer. You need to check if the options passed are valid. I think at this point in the for the options, just need. Yeah, the options argument should be zero. So you just need to pass zero. So you should just only just like make sure the values are valid. So. If you haven't, as it says, if you haven't implemented any options for the wait PID, then you should check you're not receiving values for not implemented options. So that's for the options, and then return and exit status and the status pointer. That is retrieved or collected through the exit. And here, in wait PID, you should use a synchronization primitive that will allow the parent process to wait for the child process. So that parent process should go to sleep, waiting for the child process to exit. So you should think about having the synchronization primitive implemented. Okay. We have also the exit process call, syscall, then that calls the current process to exit. And if we look into the arguments that it, so it receives an exit code that you should store that exit code in the current process, but please keep in mind that you should use that MK wait exit macro to just like prepare the user supplied exit code, or just like to prepare the exit code that should be passed to the parent. Why is that? Because there are some exit statuses that are already being passed. So what it will do, it will append your exit code to the already passed exit status, and then prepare that for you and send it back to the, or set the exit code in the process structure. So after setting the exit code in the process structure, you need to indicate in the child process structure that that child process did exit. And the exit status value. Once you're done with that, you call thread exit. So the thread has just like a ready for you to use a framework, just like in fork, you're gonna use thread fork, and exit, you're gonna use thread exit. Something similar to the file syscall that you already used. You did the, for example, the output checking, and then you use the vnode helper macros or the DFS layer functions that would help you to do the remaining work for these syscalls. The same goes with fork and exit here, for example. Now, execv. Any questions up until this one? Execv is the most difficult syscall that you need to implement. So, any questions? Okay. So, execv. What is execv? Execv basically takes a newly created process and replaces the current program with a newly loaded program. So, when we fork and create a new process, that process holds the program that was the same as the program of the parent process. So when you call execv, you're going to replace that program with the program that the child process should run. We did brought up here the run program because they have a similar functionality, but with some differences. For example, run program is responsible for running program from the kernel medium using the, for example, P as you already done before. But with the execv is the one that would be used with the shell. So if you go into your kernel, I think it's the old. If you enter the S option, it will go into the shell, and then from there you can start using calling user program. And here where execv comes into play and will be used. So execv and run program do have some similarities. So if we go through the code of run program, then we're gonna see that, so it's gonna receive the program name, opens the program, the DFS open, it will create an address space, load the executable, load elf, and enter new process. So all these stuff, or even as defined stack, which sets the user stack. So all these are similar to what you will also have in execv. So the DFS open, create, AS create, load L, the stack pointer, define stack, and then you have the enter new process function. So these are the similarities. What are the differences? Run program is where you initialize the console. But in execv, as we said, you don't need to initialize the console, because we said that the console should be initialized only once with the first user process, and then should be copied out as you fork. So one of the differences is that run program is the place where you initialize the console, but execv doesn't initialize console. Execv handles receives arguments from the user space, so it needs to copy them into the kernel space and then copy them back into the user space, and that's what run program doesn't do because it's already in the kernel space. So these are the similarities and differences between execv and run program. So if we go through an example here, let's say we started the shell in our OS161 kernel, and then we called that program arg test, and we passed these arguments through OS161 and var. So the signature for the exec syscall . So it receives a pointer, character pointer of the program name, and then it receives pointer to an array of pointers, which is the args. So, and that's basically which the array that holds the arguments. So here is the most difficult part for execv, which is you need to now, after you see this stuff from the user space, you need to copy them into the kernel space. And then you need, before you pass them back to the user, you need to organize them in some way that will be accessible to the user and put them in the user stack. So a lot of computation gonna be should happen here. So for the execv, what it receives a pointer program, which basically points to the program name, and then it receives, as we said, a pointer to array of pointers. So the args is a pointer that points to array of pointers. So the first index in that array basically points back to the program name, and that's NURBS convention. Starting the args, the first index in that array, is where you're going to receive your arguments. So as you can see, the first index has a pointer to a string or array of characters, which is foo, and that should be null terminated. So keep in mind that both your args array should be, the array itself should be non-terminated. That means you should have an extra index into that array that is a null pointer. And the args, basically, because since they are strings or array of characters, then by default they should be non-terminated. So as we can see, each argument in the array, each index in the array points to the one of the arguments. Now, how does execv work? First, you need to copy the arguments, the program, and args into the kernel space, and then start doing whatever the run program does, like VFS open, the copying the address space, loadout, as stack, as defined stack, and then once you're done with that, then you need to copy the arguments back to the user. Where should you copy the arguments? You should prepare these arguments on the user stack, and that's what we're gonna go into. Let's go now. It's the right time. So you need to arrange the array of pointers that pointing to the arguments. You do need to arrange it on the user stack. So this is the user stack. And so how you should go about that? First, you need to compute the size that you need for all of these, for the array and for the arguments. So the array, as we said, is an array of pointers. That means since we have the program name, we have three arguments, and then the fifth index is a null because that array must be a null terminated array. So each of these indexes are 32-bit. The size of these should be 32-bit because basically they are pointers, so they are 32-bit. So other than that, since they are pointers, then they should point to the beginning of the arguments. So after computing the size of the array, what you need for the array, then you need to compute the size for the argument that you receive. And how should you place these? So we know that the user stack is, by convention, it's a 4-byte. So each block is a 4-byte. That means we can place 4 characters in every block, since every character takes 1 byte. So if the argument is less than 4 bytes, then we should be fine, because we can place the argument and the terminating null into the same block. But if the argument is more than 4 bytes, that means we need to allocate more blocks for that argument. And we shouldn't combine two arguments in the same block. Once you're done with one argument, if you have some bytes left, then you need to pad them using number. And this is what's happening here. So in our example, we passed foo os161 and bar as arguments. And we have the test pen slash argtest as the program name. So let's see how this is organized here. So as we said, the first index in that array points to the program name. So we're going to start just like slash TES. So each character is going to take one byte. So every block, four bytes. So we're going to continue up until the end. So if you can see that the program name by itself takes exactly four blocks, but still it's not terminated. So technically, you do need to allocate one more block to terminate that. That's just an example, just to make you understand. So the actual implementation basically differ, but having the argument not terminated, this is a must. You have that in the man page. This is very important. So the args argument is an array of zero terminated string. The array itself should be terminated by a null pointer. So this is a requirement that you should really handle in your implementation and how you organize the array and the arguments. So it doesn't really matter how you really organize the arguments themselves, because as long as you have the array, you did know how you organize your array, and each index in that array has the address of the beginning of the argument, and the argument should be not terminated, so you know where it starts, where it ends. But the important thing is that once you're done organizing all that, so as we said, we need to compute the size of these, of the whole thing, then you can just like advance your stack pointer so you have that space reserved, and then you start putting these arguments into that, allocating and putting the arguments into the stack. And once done, you need to make sure the stack pointer and the arg pointer are set to the end of your space where you allocated for these arguments. So keep in mind that the user stack pointer starts at the address 0x80,000,000 and grows downward. This is the convention of the address space. So make sure once you're done with allocating all of this, you have the user stack pointer and arg pointing to the right place. It should be here. So this is how you should copy out your arguments back to the user space. And then you return to the user space using the enter new process function that is implemented in trap.c. And note that, to understand things, that function takes argc and argv, and these are the same variables or arguments that are received by you whenever you write a C program. In the main program, you have you receive two arguments, which is the argc and the argv. These are the same as the ones that are in a new process. So make sure you set the argc and argv correctly. So argc, as we said, it's the number of arguments that you have, and argv is a pointer to array, to array of pointers pointing to the arguments. So a few points that you need to consider while copying arguments from kernel space to user space: that you should copy the arguments on the user stack, and MIPS pointer should be aligned by 4. where to place stack pointer and arg. This is what we mentioned after that space that you allocated for the arguments. And then, so because every index in the array of pointers that rv points to is an array, so it's a pointer, that means it is of size 32 bits. So each address in the, so each index in the, that array holding an address to the beginning of the argument, and then the argument should be not terminated. So use padding to just like not have two arguments in the same block on your stack. Okay, and also for some stuff that I forgot to mention. Yeah, the MK wait for the exit syscall, the MK wait exit macro is defined in your wait.h. You can go through that. So you have all the, these are the encoding macros used by the conditional wait result. So this is the macro that you need to use with the exit syscall to prepare your exit code. So it will basically append your exit code to whatever exit status or exit code that been created previously. Also, so for the PID, allocating a new PID to limits, so as we said, the min PID should, the PID should start from 2. Min PID should start from 2, and the first PID, these are reserved for the kernel to use. And you should use an increasing counter for your PID. This is one way to do it, and the recommended way of doing it. So yeah, that's all I have for today. Any question on or any of the process syscalls or say the wait exits? You have a question?
Yes, do you need to worry about the process exiting through a signal? So like, I know the way to command the command discusses MQ86, so do you need to worry about that?
Yeah, thanks.
Anyway,
exiting through a signal?
It's in wait.
Yeah, wait.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
I'm not sure, I need to check over that. Yeah, the waiting wait. Carl, do we need to handle the for a process exiting through a signal?
Not directly. In other words, there's no formal signal process subsystem in OS 161. There is one corner case sometimes when, let's say, a process catches a page fault. It's handled as an apparent signal. If you look in like trap.c, there's some code for that. But yeah, you don't have to worry about the case of a process getting a signal in a formal sense, because there is no signaling subsystem, unless you want to write one.
Any other
questions? Do we have to let the straight away start allocating memory from 0x80 million for the user stack?
So the user stack starts from the 0x80 million, and this is, and you should draw down, download. Yes, starting from that address, drawing download. You compute the size, advance your start pointer, and then you start allocating with the back space. Yes.
So in this args of 0, args of 1, args of 2, there are pointers.
Yeah.
So in case I have a character buffer of, in case I have a buffer of so and so size, how do I allocate No, three. So, I'll discuss that in class.
Any other questions? Okay, thanks for coming. That's all for today. We might start with assignment 3 next week. So, good luck with assignment 3.